Kyle Waits does a good job. Denny Rowan would do it, I think. Rowan guitars, although I don't know if he does setups. He does like major repairs. He's a luthier, you know. I guess a setup is Waits.
in. I can feel the winds as they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
Feel my hope about to break. I will preach to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock.
I can see the morning light. I can feel the joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. Stand on solid ground.
When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters calm and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock.
Christ is solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ is solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock.
On Christ is solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet.
All right, before we take our seats, why don't we turn and wave to one another our passing of the peace, and without the masks, we can see the bright smiles on each and every one of our faces. So I invite you to be seated, and let me introduce myself. My name is Matt Hadley. I'm the senior pastor here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay, and I welcome you to this time of worship as we gather together, whether we are here in the sanctuary or in the comfort of our own homes on our devices. You still are a part of us. We are a whole community of faith, whether we are in person or whether we are live streaming. We value prayer here very, very much. And so if you would like to send in an item of joy or an item of concern, whether you're here in the sanctuary or at home, please text those prayers to 414-331-2691. And when we have the prayers of the people, we will lift them up together. Well, when I was driving in today, I was looking at the thermometer on my car, and it said beautiful. Just said beautiful. Today would be a great day for a walk. And walking in faith is our theme for our preaching moment. And so hopefully when we walk out of the house of worship today, you will indeed be walking by faith. Now, we are an intergenerational church, and so we value the very, very young and the very, very experienced. And one of the people that is set aside to help us with our children and youth is a man named Andrew Jones. And I'm going to invite Pastor Andrew to come forward. For those of you who maybe haven't seen Andrew, Andrew is a gifted individual, a good pastor, a great leader. He's innovative and creative, and I have hired him twice in nationwide searches. Yeah. What were you thinking?
I don't know. I just wonder how much I owe you for all those experienced and gifted and all that stuff.
Yeah, well, appreciate it. All right, so do you have any plans for Tuesday of this week?
Well, Tuesday I will actually, hopefully, God willing, we have a clergy session on Monday, but I will be ordained on Tuesday as a deacon in Full Connection.
All right, let's show our appreciation. That's not a small feat. You know, called by God, set aside for a sacred service, and it's been a long journey. I mean, you didn't start in ministry. You started out in education, public schools. Mm-hmm. You have your master's there. What's your master's in? Curriculum?
Curriculum and instruction, yes.
All right. And now you went off to seminary, and he has a specialization in being awesome with kids and youth. And so I hope that we really will all celebrate and give him a pat on the back next time you see him, whether it's today on your way out or as we go about and about. So yes, this is annual conference. And unless there's a huge surprise, I will be appointed for the sixth time to be the senior pastor here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. And it feels like we're starting all over again, doesn't it? As we come out of this pandemic, it's starting completely over. And we know that on July the 1st, everything's going to be back open unless there's some weird variant that comes through here. But if you see Andrew wearing masks, that's because he works with the children. He's fully vaccinated, but he works with an age of children that are not yet able to have any vaccines. So don't mask shame Andrew, and don't mask shame anybody who's wearing a mask. We just are so appreciative that it looks like we're coming through at the end of this. So do you want to introduce this children's moment at all? We didn't rehearse this at all, can you tell?
Right, right. Well, this one is, I have a little science experiment for you about living by faith, so enjoy.
Now, they experienced God through the love of Paul and his other friends. They experienced God through the Holy Spirit, but they never actually saw God. They really struggled with how to live that out. Paul was reminding them that we live by faith and not by sight. It's not just what we see that's important. It's the way we experience God through one another, through the Holy Spirit, and the way that we give love by loving one another. Here's an example of how we can experience something without actually seeing it. So here I have a tube of water. And now I have another tube that I'm filling up with oil. These are going to be the different environments that we might see in our lives. Now imagine I put a test tube in the water. Now you can still see it even though it goes all the way in the water. You can still see that the test tube is there. You watched it go in, so you know it's there. Now I'm going to put a test tube here in the oil. Now you can see it go in, but in a moment we're going to find out, wow, it disappeared. Look at that again. You can watch it actually go inside. You know it's there, right? And here we'll see the test tube go in the oil. You see it in there, and then suddenly, it's vanished. What happened? The test tube is still there. It just has appeared to vanish. It's still inside the cup.
So just like the Corinthians had to trust in God and trust that Paul was giving them good news, we can learn to trust others. We can learn to trust God by experiencing the love of our church, by experiencing the love of the people around us and our family. We don't have to see to believe everything that's going on. Let's pray together, friends. Gracious God, help us to believe even when we can't see the things in front of us. We love you, God, and we pray these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you.
broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? 'Cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall surrendered to the floor. You make all things new. You make all things new.
God of mercy and love, you are with us in all times, and for this we give you thanks. You are a God of new beginnings, and each morning you delight our eyes with the tender green shoots of early summer, and you awaken our ears to sounds that we miss when we are closed off from the natural world. Though we see and hear so much around us that is beautiful, teach us, we pray, to look beyond what is apparent before us, to see where there are needs, whether in our own community or outside of it, that you are calling us to attend to. May we sense Jesus walking closely with us, guiding us to walk as he did, for the sake of a broken world which you wish to make new. We confess, O God, that often we have lived selfishly, thinking of our own needs and desires. Too often we have not walked by faith. Forgive us, Holy One, when we live as if we had not been made new by your Spirit's power. Renew us this day and shift our priorities so that we might truly live for one another, bearing the good news of your love and grace to everyone everywhere through our words and deeds. Yet with all that is happening in the world these days, Lord, we scarcely know where to start as we offer prayers for healing, wholeness, peace, security, comfort, and joy for all your children. Although we cannot see the needs as you do, at least we can offer prayers for all creation and all creatures, and especially for those in this body who have special requests to make today.
We lift up a special prayer for Sean Carth, as he's been continuously dealing with mental and physical health issues. Prayers that God will give him healing and strength. Prayers of thankfulness and joy for the birth of Tom and Susie Webster's granddaughter, Ada May. Thanks for the blessing for Christy and Luke with this precious child. Prayers for a successful annual conference for the United Methodist Church to be held this weekend in Wisconsin. Prayers for our bishop as he leads the proceedings, for all the clergy and lay delegates, that they may make wise decisions that benefit the whole church, and prayers for the congregation who listen in, that they may more fully understand the workings of the conference and the denomination. A prayer of joy that Pastor Andrew will be ordained. Continued prayers for the health of Pat Kissinger. And finally, we give thanks to God for Larry Mackey sharing his gifts with the praise team. These are the prayers of our people.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Do what only you can do, Lord, and make all things new. And help us remember that it is through brokenness that healing and new life can come, and that through the waters of grace comes cleansing and rebirth. We give thanks that we have learned these things through Jesus our Lord, who taught his followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As God has given so graciously to us, we are called to give back to him by helping the work of the Church of Jesus Christ in the world. And so we have the opportunity to make our tithes and offerings and to bring them before the Lord. If you're in the sanctuary, there is a box down front, as you well know, where you may leave your gifts. If you're at home, of course, you may text or go online to give your gifts, or simply get them to the church office in person or by mail. We also have a mission of the month for the month of June, which is Habitat for Humanity, and all loose coins and designated checks or cash for Habitat will go to support the work that they do, especially right here, well, I think entirely right here in the Milwaukee area. And if I'm not mistaken, we still have our tool drive going on through the month of June, where new or gently used tools are, you're invited to donate those, which will go to Habitat and help their work. Let us give thanks in our hearts for all that God has given us and for all the ways we are called to give back to God.
Thank you. just a closer walk with thee.
Thank you, Sonny. That was beautiful, very moving. We are in our second week in a sermon series called Letters to a Dysfunctional Church. And we know that the Apostle Paul wrote these letters of instruction and letters of correction to these small communities of faith that weren't quite doing it the right way. They didn't figure it out. There was a lot of naughtiness happening. And so in Corinth, is perhaps the one that was the most rough and tumble kind of a town. And so Paul is writing to them and encouraging them. And even though they have rejected him a couple of times, he does not give up. His faith is strong. His love of that community of faith is strong. Before I read our passage for today, I want to share a story that I read by a pastor named Rodney Johnson. And he talks about something that took place up there at Niagara Falls. How many of you have ever been to Niagara Falls? I've been there a couple of times, both times on the Canada side. And just the sheer power and majesty of it is amazing. I like to stand right where the water is rushing and just before it goes down, and then you just move a few feet away and you can really get a sense of the power of this beautiful piece of nature. Well, Johnson tells this story about a man who fashioned a tightrope wire across from the American side to the Canadian side. And he got up and there was a crowd that had gathered. There's always a crowd right there. And he said, "Who believes that I can walk across the Niagara Falls on this tightrope?" It was a little bit windy, and no one said that he could. Matter of fact, I think most of them didn't even want to see him try it because they were afraid what they were going to witness, his peril, his fall. So nobody said he could. So he got up there, and he walked across the falls, turned around, and walked back. People were impressed. They were clapping, just like we clapped after Sonny sang that beautiful song. And then he said, "Who here believes that I can walk across this tightrope while pushing a wheelbarrow?" People said, "Oh, no one believed he could do it." So he got up there with a wheelbarrow, walked across the falls from Canada to America, turned around, and walked back to Canada. People were impressed. He said, "Who here believes that I can walk across this tight wire with a person in the wheelbarrow?" Now, they didn't believe he could do it without any props. They didn't believe he could do it with a wheelbarrow, but they saw it with their own eyes. And they said, "Yes, we know you can. You can do it. You can do it." And he said, "Okay, who is going to volunteer?" Nobody said, "Here I am." I think the story has a lot to say about most of our faith journeys. I mean, who here would get into that wheelbarrow, even though you knew that he could do it because he was so steady? And here's how Johnson summarizes this. He says, "This story exemplifies how we walk with Christ. We believe what the Bible says and the testimony of others. We just don't believe it unquestioningly when it comes to us. We preach, live by faith, but we practice living by sight. Afraid to take that step of faith." But brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you that we are called metaphorically and sometimes literally to walk forward with Christ, not knowing what may be ahead. Walking in faith. We know that you cannot stand still and be a Christian. We need to do more than talk the talk. We need to walk the walk. And so let's come to this letter, the second letter to Corinthians. I'm in chapter 5, and I have two segments of this passage that I'm going to read to us. And these words say, "So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died, and he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We no longer know him in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, before I really get into the "we walk by faith," there are three other things that really jump out from that passage that just kind of strike me. And the first was when Paul said, "We must all of us appear before the judgment seat of Christ." You ever sat through a sermon where the pastor was doing the best that he or she could to scare the hell out of you? Right? Just trying to scare you with fear of damnation, fear of eternal torment. I've always thought it better to love somebody into relationship with Jesus Christ instead of scare them I don't think our love can ever truly be full if it's based on fear. But when I read this, yes, Paul says these words, but Paul does not even have the slightest hint of a fearful understanding of the last judgment. And so Paul will not stoop to fear-mongering as so many pastors do. Matter of fact, we know that Paul wrote to the church in Rome, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one that died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, and who is indeed interceding for us. Now, Paul has no fear because he knows he has this right relationship with God, and he knows that as the psalmist says, the Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. Now, we all mess up. We all make mistakes. There are times where we maybe even knowingly or unknowingly hurt someone else because of our selfish ambitions, but we know that if we confess our sins, all of us have no need to fear condemnation because our slate can be wiped clean. You know, time and time again, Jesus made it clear that he did not come to condemn. The woman caught in adultery, she says, "Do you condemn me?" He said, "No." And in the gospel in a nutshell, in the third chapter of John, after saying, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but have everlasting life," he says this, "Indeed, God did not send the son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only son of God." What are the ways in which we might condemn ourselves? Something that is not in the nature of Christ. The second thing that kind of caught my attention as I was reading this passage again this week is that phrase, "even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view." If I were to ask you, who is Jesus? What answers would you give? At our lectionary Bible study on Wednesday night, I asked that question, and I received a wonderful array of answers to that very question. But Paul did know Jesus from a human point of view, had this understanding before he had his conversion, before he was knocked off his horse and heard the voice of God. When Paul saw Jesus from a human point of view, he saw him as a radical and a threat that as such had to be killed. And he knew that his followers that were doing the same kind of ministry that Jesus did, they needed to be exterminated as well. And that was his mission. That was his goal until God got a hold of him. Who do you say Jesus is? Do you know him from a purely human point of view? Or do you see Jesus as God? Who do you say Jesus of Nazareth is? Because it's impossible for us to say that he's a myth, that he's a legend. No, we know that there was such a man, Jesus, who lived from Nazareth, who was crucified. We have historical records of it. But what would you say? You know, some people say he's just a wisdom teacher, one of the great wisdom teachers ever. Some say he was just a champion of social justice. But I have given my life to saying and proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the Lord who, yes, taught with wisdom and, yes, was a champion for justice, but also who died that I might have a right relationship with the God who created me and the God who loved me and you so much that became flesh through Emmanuel, the God that continues to sustain us through the Holy Spirit to strengthen our Christian walk. The third thing that jumped out at me before I really get to what I want to talk about. Don't worry, this sermon's not going to be 35 minutes long. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. And so you wonder, have you ever known someone whose life really did change 180? Because suddenly the love of God got in their hearts and suddenly they started to respond differently? I'm always a little leery of someone who says, "Oh yes, I am a devout Christian," but then I take a look at what they're doing and they're not different at all than anyone else who is doing the kinds of things that the rest of society is doing. We who proclaim the love of Christ, we who wear the name Christian, are constantly in a tug of war with our desire to conform with society. Paul, who is writing this letter to Corinth, also wrote to the church in Rome, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you might discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." Do not conform. Become new. Become new, a new creation who is empowered and equipped to do wonderful things for the least, the last, the lost, the lonely, the left out, the left behind. He is encouraging them to live by what Jesus taught, not by what they were seeing happen in Corinth with temple prostitution, with people exploiting one another, the terrible treatment of those who are of the lower class. No, be different. Be something new. You know, when I think about conversion, some things do change and some things stay the same. And in the Serendipity Study Bible, which has questions, one of their questions says this, and I hope you think about it this week. How is the new creation both instantaneous and ongoing? How is it both instantaneous and ongoing? And so we wrestle with all those things, but we come to the proclamation of this day that we are called to walk by faith, not by sight. And let me tell you what that does not mean. That does not mean that we walk blindly. Yes, we walk by faith, not by sight, but we're not walking blind. No, we have eyes to see those that the rest of the world says is invisible. We have eyes that see, but we walk by faith. What does it mean to walk by faith? We all know what it is to walk. Let me illustrate. And some of us even have these things in our pocket called pedometers. I have walked today 2,359.60 steps. I know for a fact, because I knew I was going to do this today, that it takes me 519 steps to get from where I park to come to church on Sunday morning so that I can leave space for everyone else that doesn't have 519 steps in them. We wear these pedometers because a lot of us have goals. Fitness goals about walking. I have a goal this year to make sure I walk at least 2,021 miles because it's the year 2021. It's attainable and I can track it. But I wonder, has anyone here ever set a walk by faith goal? Do we have goals in our faith journey? If so, what would they look like? Who would they benefit? I think we need to take it seriously. Yes, we know what it is to walk, but what about faith? What about faith? Faith, we know, according to Webster, and Webster is not the Bible, Webster says, unquestioning belief, complete trust or confidence, loyalty. But do we know what the Bible's definition of faith is? We hear it in the book of Hebrews. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. So we walk by faith. Paul says, therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so too might we walk in the newness of life. Christianity is something that is called the way. It is a movement, and we have done a great disservice to the church by institutionalizing it. We need to continue to be on the move, moving forward for the gospel. Walking by faith is walking in the reality of God's love and of God's grace. And this love should affect us deeply, and it should become the basis of our lives, of our words, of our deeds, of our journey. I believe walking by faith means to open ourselves to the changing power of a relationship with God. Christians walk a different walk. Not only do we walk a different path, but we also walk in a different manner. And the difference is caused by our active and dynamic relationship with the living God, one that we don't just call Jesus of Nazareth, one that we call Jesus Christ. And Paul was trying to convey all of this. A pastor named Barger Elliott said, in Paul's mind, our faith in Jesus does not inoculate us against the reality of hardship, but reframes our life with Christ at the center, the Christ who suffered on our behalf. When we come to discern this truth, we also discover the true source of our strength in the person of Jesus Christ. And so, brothers and sisters, walk on. Walk on in the strength, in the source of our strength. As God's people, let's be on the move. Amen. I invite our praise team to reassemble as we worship God through song. I invite you to stand as you are willing and able.
One word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you hear what's broken inside me. Just one word, you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Nothing that our God can't do. All things are possible with Christ. Just a few items for us to be in the know so we can continue to be a dynamic community of faith. We have a book study this summer on racial diversity, The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander. That's starting tomorrow night. This Thursday, our office is going to be closed as we are having our annual staff planning session. We're going to gather together as a staff and map out the entire next year. And it's going to be really exciting to plan out a year where we can be together, where we can have our building open, and where we can really truly be the hands and feet. On Thursday, starting in June 24th, a three-session class that Pastor Janet is leading on living fully and dying well. Mark your calendars. The 4th of July falls on a Sunday this year, and we know that there is a big parade here in Whitefish Bay, and which means parking, which is already difficult, is going to be impossible. And so we're going to have a single service that day at 9 o'clock in the morning. The parade starts at 11:30. That way we can come in and get out. I invite you to bring friends. Make a day of it. Bring a friend and then just walk down the road and see the parade later after getting a cup of coffee.
As Janet mentioned, our Habitat Tool Drive continues. We also are still collecting food and household items. Special thanks to everyone who has volunteered to help with our hospitality. We can always use more smiling, wonderful faces to help greet people and to be in mission and service here at the church. And thank you to everyone who has already put your pledge card in. Our fiscal year starts July the 1st. So if you have your pledge cards, mail them in, or you can just leave them in the offering box. And so, brothers and sisters, we have a source of strength that words are hard to describe. And this source of strength empowers us to walk the Christian walk, to be the hands and the feet. Even though we can't see the ultimate end, we know by faith that we are called to be followers of Jesus Christ. Go in peace, friends. Walk in peace. Still have to have that to ride the bus, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.